So we've got it. So welcome again, everybody. And we're really looking forward to celebrating and acknowledging Michael Abbensetts on this particular day of his...
David.
So the housekeeping is, I suppose, just to keep yourselves on mute. Make sure you can see the screen. Sorry, I'm just trying to do that. So this is where we're at. We're remembering Michael Abbensetts on this. Well, yesterday was the transitioned, and I could have done it yesterday, but I had another meeting and that meeting canceled. So I was a little bit like, oh, okay, never mind. Doing it today. And my name is Dr. Michelle Asantua. These, for those of you who are not aware of what I am, who I am, what I do, this is what I do. I'm a writer, lecturer, and publisher. And I founded Way With Words, which is a platform, a multidisciplinary platform that does publishing, editing, tuition. I also do cultural consultancy, among other things. And this is just to show you that these are some of the books that I have self-published and actually published. This one on the far right here, who's a young Guyanese Chinese author, Scott Tingaki. So as well as my own publications, I do others as well. And this one is an anthology on the left, published last year. And it's, so I have people in there, writers and artists who have never had anything published. So I try to get as many people who will be first time publishers as much as possible. And this is my first novel on the right, Elijah, but this is it in its second edition format, which has just recently been released and is now available. I just wanted to hint to some of you, perhaps Craig, who's in London, that some of these things are happening at the BFI. And I'm reason why I'm showing you it is because it's part of the African Odysseys program, which I am one of the steering group members on. So that's a sort of a preview of a Kurosawan film that's on Saturday. And then this is another one. They do these senior matinees. Obviously it's like on a curious time, Monday at 2 o'clock, but you know, they're just thinking about the seniors. But they're very rarely seen films. And some years ago, I actually took my mum and I took Uncle Eric as well. Uncle, that's where we went to see Stormy Weather. And this is, I think, Attenda, you, who's on here as well, you had taken your father. So this is one, so I was just promoting that. That's also part of the African Odysseys program that I'm part of. That's a more, that, at least that's a visual that you can see. Family feel good film. Few of you on here, any of you on here who are interested in writing, Way With Words has received this award fund so that we could offer this 12-week writing course, particularly around healing and well-being and things like that. So if you're interested in that, you can email me and I'll send you the details. Okay, now we move swiftly on to the reason why you all come on here. And these are some of the publications for Michael's work, which I have the one in the middle, but the others I don't, I've not seen the others obviously. And I was privy to a reading of Sweet Talk some years ago, which I'll sort of mention later on. And I've never seen, obviously, I've not seen the reading, the script of Samba either. So these are all new to me, but certainly the ones in the middle, I have that collection because I knew him at the time that that collection of his plays were published. And it's there, that one is still available online, I think, to purchase. But I got these from Wikipedia, just so that you can have panorama of, sorry about the noise, I live on the main road, a panorama of an idea of his productiveness. And so, yeah, this is just to give you an idea of the how prolific a producer of art and writing Michael really was. At the time of my meeting him, he had done all of what you see before you and was still writing more, which some of were put on, like in Doctor Series, for example, which he wrote a number of episodes for. Okay, that's my thing going. Okay, so I'm really pleased that Michael's sister is here because one of these in this image is you. What's your name though? I don't know your name. Elizabeth was one?
Neville. Oh, yeah. Neville John.
No.
This is Michael at the back.
Yes, that's Michael. And I'm over to his...
Where I'm circling.
That's me, yes.
Yes, and this is your sister.
My sister Annette.
That's your mother. And your...
And my father.
Yes, who's the doctor.
Neville, yes.
So, great. I mean, I love this photo. I'm trying to think how... This photo was probably at the time of Michael's passing. It might have been via Liz. That might be how I have these photos. And this cool looking one of Michael here. This is before he comes to London. I believe it looks to me like he's in Guyana. Or he went to Canada, right? First, so I'm not sure, but I thought it was Guyana. It has Guyana look about it. And he looks young enough to have been in Guyana at the time. The title that you're seeing there is really what I'm going to be reading from, because that was what I wrote at the time of his passing. I actually published that writing. It was a blog post, an article. I did that. So that was published on the 25th of November. Interestingly enough, and here I'm not sure who this gentleman is.
That's Dr. Abbensetts, Michael's father and my father
and my granddad. Yeah.
Oh, this one here is Michael's father as well.
Yes, uh-huh. Michael's father.
Yes, because I was.
And my father.
Is he an actor?
Craig's granddad.
Yes, and this is him here again.
Great, great granddad, wouldn't he be? Sorry, yes.
No, carry on. This is you, and this is your sister.
Annette, yes.
And this was it in Canada?
No, that's in Derbyshire. That's our back garden that me and Tanya, we grew up in. I recognise it.
Amazing!
Yeah.
So I have answers. It's like, yeah. I see these photos, I have them, I love, I even did a card with them all, and I'm like, I can't really say who or what. And so which house is Michael in here?
Yeah.
This, I don't know where that is.
Because I wondered whether it was, I thought to myself it might have been in his house, but the one in Wilsdon, but I'm not sure about the steps look a bit different. But anyway, right, okay. let me start how I had
our family home where my father is and Michael is.
Okay, all right, okay. In which country though is that?
Guyana in South America.
Okay.
It used to be British Guiana.
Yeah, I was born there too myself.
Yeah.
I'm Guyanese. There is a link as well to there.
But,
so really, I'm going to read from the article, and then I will intersperse it with these with some other images. But these were the oldest image, if you like, that I have of Michael. And so it's from it's following his passing. This is what I wrote: that the first time we met, we had a disagreement. I don't recall exactly what we argued about. He had been invited by my university, London Met. It was then University of North London, where I was a student at the time, to be a writer in residence. He attended one of our classes. I think it was other literatures in English. And something he said did not sit right with me. I objected. He returned some comment. I returned another. And the teacher, having let us bash words for a while, perhaps he was laughing at this, had to stop us. For we had taken over the class, two stubborn Guyanese arguing over what I can't remember now, just that this was our first meeting. It was the beginning of, it was actually the beginning of our friendship, and maybe why I remember the time. He was not offended, but in fact asked my tutor to invite me to a reading of one of his plays at the Tricycle Theatre. He wanted me to tell him what I thought about the play that he was now doing. He wanted me to, yeah, and I did, and always would then, when he later shared his other works in progress with me. I marveled that he cared what I thought, but went along with it. He too remembered our first meeting because it concerned him that I was the only student to even say something in response to his talk. Others sat there listening. I think he wondered whether any of them was also thinking. I had never heard about him before that visit to my university. Didn't realize that he was part of that generation of Guyanese, or for that matter, Caribbean writers who had migrated in the 50s, 60s, to make their contributions to the literary world here in the UK. Michael was a Queen's College pupil between 1952 and 1956, as many children from middle-class backgrounds were. His father, Neville John Abbensetts, was a doctor. His mother kept home and both were very strict, so he told me. His father didn't like that Michael chose the economically precarious profession of writing over the supposedly financially sound choices of lawyer, doctor, architect, and so on. The dispute between them over it persisted throughout Michael's life. I suspect he sometimes very slightly regretted that this was one of the major outcomes of his decision to become a writer. Let me just move to another couple of slides. That's another one of him here. But a playwright he was. At that time, when he came to London in 1963, there weren't many. His first play, Sweet Talk, opened at the Royal Court in 1973. From our conversations, I gather he was hot stuff during those days, owing to the success of Sweet Talk. His work was fresh and spoke to Britain's theatre goers' curiosities about Black people being here at all. He didn't struggle, as he would later, to get plays put on. The TV drama series, which is how he saw it, and not as a soap, as it was deemed, Empire Road, ran on BBC Two from 1978 to 1979, the first of its kind, and one of few since that time. In fact, I don't think there's any like that, really. Anyway, he regretted the title, which people thought suggested it was a Black version of Coronation Street. But by having fully Black cast, predominantly, and including different minorities to whom the term Black applied politically, he was making a statement about the lack of Black characters in programs like Coronation Street, when we were very much part of the UK by late 1970s. The lead character, Everton Bennett, played by Norman Beaton, was called the Godfather, which Michael said was not criminal, but caring. See if I have another. Yeah, this is the radio time still of that program. So he was saying the lead character, sorry, Everton Bennett, played by Norman Beaton, was called the Godfather, which Michael said was not criminal but caring. He was morally upstanding, someone in the community to whom others could take their problems. Michael explained that though there were a lot of such Black men in the community, many writers, himself included, wrote about the angry or promiscuous types for the sake of producing drama. In so doing, he acknowledged, "We are unfair to all the black men who are wonderful role models, and I definitely wanted to portray that with The Godfather in Empire Road." Let's see what else we got back here. Ah, okay. So we can watch this clip from Empire Road now. It's good that you're on here, Justine, because in your world somewhere, there are episodes of a lot of these plays and episodes of Empire Road, which others we don't have access to because they are in the vault somewhere. But on YouTube, there is this half a clip, and I've just abridged some of it for us to have a look at Michael's work.
Isaac. Good afternoon.
I might as well tell you now I ain't got it.
Don't say that, Miss May.
It's pigtail soup you want, sir? Force yourself, go on.
I come about other things.
Have some soup first.
The rent, Miss May.
Forget it. Try the pigtail soup instead.
The rent, please.
Here. Who are you shouting at? Don't shout at me in my own kitchen.
Sorry, but it's due today, your rent.
Next week, I'll pay you next week.
Today?
You don't understand English. I tell you I can't pay you till next week.
But he's coming back today.
Who that?
The boss is coming back today.
Bennett the landlord. Coming back today.
And if I don't have the rent, kill me.
Rubbish. He married your sister.
Yeah, and he blames me for that as well.
Lads, reckon they know I'm back.
Preparing a big welcome to me.
A limbs. When will things get better? Down Empire Road. Got to work all day, but that is the way.
Yes, well, do we know? Take this.
Hello, Bonner. Hello, Marcus. So.
Just don't stand there, Walter.
Oh, well, he was only trying to say welcome.
It takes your brother 20 minutes to say what it takes normal people 20 seconds.
Well, most of that ever,
huh? Hasn't changed a bit, has he? I'm talking about you, Mr. Hyena.
When will things get better?
I'm dying for a cup of tea.
And what do you think I'm doing with this teapot?
I don't know. But if it was a cow, I would say it was milking it.
So, how is
it? Where's
Guyana?
Oh, Lord, man. I hope you provide a towel with your showers.
Avatar.
Brother's practicing to be a punk rocker.
Well, how was it? Guyana.
Boy, you wouldn't recognize the place.
That ain't true, Walter.
Don't worry, no, Walter. The place has changed completely. I was glad to rush back to England.
Anyway, Guyana is still my home.
Home? What home? England is your home now, woman. So, Walter, you had any trouble since we've been away?
Well, I had a bit of trouble right there.
Is this man sane? Business troubles, Walter, not back troubles. Me shop and me houses.
Oh.
All right. I've only been back 5 minutes and already I'm headed for a nervous breakdown. What about the rents? I hope you got everybody's rent up to date.
Well?
A well is a thing you just dig in the ground for water. I'm talking about money, not water. Look, tell me calmly before. When I went away, I left you in charge of 4 houses. You haven't sold them by any chance, have you? I mean, I still own 4 houses, don't I?
Well, of course you do. Oh, it's joking, isn't
you? Joking? God, give me strength. Okay, I'll tell you what. I'll go and see for myself.
Now?
Why not? Give me the keys. Some of them might be at work.
But you only just arrived.
So? I'm the landlord, and I? There's my properties and it. I'll just go and say hello. I'll see you later.
What about the shop?
That can wait till tomorrow.
Morty Walter?
So, that thing's Banner?
Don't start that again, Marcus.
Start what, Mother?
Calling everybody Banner. This is your uncle. Have some respect.
Okay. So, that thing's Uncle Banner?
Marcus?
Street party.
Oh, so that's what all those flags were about.
Walter? Oh, Walter? No. Where is that stuttering fool?
He's up there.
Jigaboos. You know what he's done? You know what that brother of yours has done?
Not so loud, Everton, the neighbors.
Are you listening to me, woman?
Yes.
He's got rid of all my best people and put in a load of strangers instead. Asians. Walter's rented one of my houses to an Asian family. You should see what they do to the front room. They turned it into a mosque temple. Mosque temple is
all the same. Okay, I wanted you to just get a little feel of, I mean, remember Michael is writing all of this and he's basing some of it obviously from his own experiences. I mean, I was listening over to a tape that I did with him when I was interviewing him and he was talking about the jigaboos comment. He knew a landlord that actually was saying this. So he's managed to insert a lot of what his own experiences into his work. And because he was doing an interracial community, he was trying to show that the diverseness of the community he was working with. So as opposed to just a one-dimensional that we would have been getting obviously with Coronation Street. So he has, this is Norman Beaton character's son, who then falls in love and eventually obviously gets married to this Indian, beautiful young sister there. And this is Norman Beaton and it potentially is his Carmen Corrin Skinner Carter, but it looks different as his wife. But anyway, I just love those photos taken for, Empire Road, let me see. And recently this program, they were trying to celebrate the 40th year of Empire Road. And this is what they were saying.
Something like 1958 to 1978, there was something called the Black and White Minstrel Show. And everybody in England used to watch it, but there was always a caricature of black people, which then enforced in the psyche of the nation that that's how black people are. So a lot of the television commissioning editors started looking at the possibility of having a lot more representation.
It was a television series about a black family, something which had never been even imagined before.
The society of that time was a hierarchical, racist, exclusive kind of society, and the industry was a reflection of that. So we kind of understood, when we saw black representation, we saw actors on stage, there was a kind of a tacit acknowledgement of what they had to overcome just to have a presence on the screen.
70s television, British television, was dominated by these really dodgy sitcoms. Love Thy Neighbor, Mixed Blessings, Mind Your Language. I mean, there was just so many. The Fosters tried to be different, but it was still fell into that kind of hole of dodgy sitcoms. And then Empire Road comes along, created by a black writer, wonderful writer called Michael Abbensetts, with a black, predominantly black cast, headed by the great Norman Beaton, Corin Skinner Carter, who I also love and respect. And it was just a very innovative, refreshing alternative.
It was a breakthrough. It was having a show. We do not have shows now, certainly not in mainstream, that is just about an ordinary family that happens to be black.
Maybe I've got a romantic view of it, but it seemed like such a seminal show for, as a representation of black British life. That idea of fusing the people who had come from the colonies, from the Caribbean, but also the black British generation who were born here, and how together they were forging this new black British identity.
Oh God, make an appointment, going to see the doctor, I'm going to be sick.
The second series, they did bring in Horace Ovay, a black director, who was working in television at that time. So that was a kind of breakthrough as well. So you had a black writer, black director. And then they axed it.
This sort of very expedient way in which a programme series like Empire Road, with its very significant and pivotal position that it occupied, was dropped because obviously, you know, the people who were making decisions felt like that was enough, you know. So I think this very tokenistic relationship, which has been the general trend of broadcasting and cinema in this country.
I think as Empire Road, it's 40th years since it was first aired. I think it's really important we recognise that because it was a landmark in British television.
40 years is a long time and lots of things have changed. We've had at least two generations in that time and some of the things that we felt were important then don't seem so important to the younger generation. I think the legacy that it has is the fact that it is possible to have this kind of shows that deals not just with black issues, but with issues about how we integrate into this society.
Empire Road was a major breakthrough in British television in terms of representation of black characters, and particularly the family, the black West Indian family. And so it should be better remembered.
It actually enriched my life. I think that there should be contributions made all around to say a big thank you to the people who created that.
Which, of course, is what we're doing. We are saying a big thank you to Michael Abbensetts for creating that. And you can see how, you know, truly remarkable and innovative what he did is, I'm hoping. Okay, so continuing with my reading, let me go on. So By the time I met him, he had written his best works, but was still writing, still trying to find that edgy material that some theatre would want to run. But the curiosity of the British theatre goers about Caribbean people had not only waned, it had changed. They expected to see stereotypes, yardies, baby fathers, gangs, violence, drug pushers and police chasing these. It was the Bill series time, if you remember. Maybe even a mimicry of the dysfunctions we saw with the white families on TV. Michael wrote short TV scripts for the series doctors, but couldn't keep up with the shift in expectations of what Black identity should look like on screen, particularly to white people. He was used to writing strong, confident, independent, and full of life, believable Black characters, and not the smiling, docile characters that prolong in programs like EastEnders. His characters were funny, feisty, and aspiring, as reflected in the mini-series Little Napoleons, which actually they did air that a few years ago. I remember seeing it. He wrote for Channel 4. He remarked that many of the Black characters on TV were not positive, or their story and the storylines weren't durable because they were written as white characters. They were written as white characters by white writers in the first place and then cast as Black. One such script ran into difficulties because the writer who was supposed to maintain a storyline with a Black character previously conceived as a white character said, he'd only lived a short time in Brixton and wasn't happy there. In other words, he had no real material to go on, but took the fat check and kept writing until he was stumped. The one-off drama, Black Christmas, which was 1977, so before Empire Road, which I saw once when I was interviewing him for an article, another article, dealt with the issue of mental depression. The main character played by Carmen Monroe, that lovely, gorgeous picture of Carmen Monroe that you're seeing there, which is the first time I was seeing it yesterday. The main character played by Carmen Monroe was trying to recreate a perfect Guyanese Christmas. The family had recently migrated to England. It was their first Christmas. She had made Christmas dinner, including the cultural black cake, but something was wrong. Her sister-in-law was in a state of mental depression, which was running parallel to the pretense of keeping up the appearance of Christmas and being somewhat arrived in the UK. Her sister-in-law's depression was in part to do with adjusting to being in the UK, but also having to deal with her husband's infidelities with white women. I think that what I was really saying is it's not just keeping up appearance, this is Michael, but that it's a conscious act of will almost that you have to adapt somehow in the new space, Michael told me. Carmen Monroe was trying to do that, but her sister-in-law was struggling. What I liked, Michael says, about Carmen Monroe's character is that she really was the strong one in the family. She held everyone together by the real strength of her character. Michael contrasted Monroe's character with that of Norman Beaton's, whom he says was listening to all kinds of white television about all kinds of things that really had nothing to do with his life. The TV is always on, sort of belching out this stuff, and his wife turns it off. And by doing this, she imposes her will on the situation. He acknowledged then that although things had moved on, there are a lot of Black people, even ones born here, who are not sure how to really deal with life here. In writing a TV drama about the issue of mental depression as experienced by Black people and the taboos surrounding it, Michael was way ahead of his time. We've not seen anything near it on our screens as far as I can recall, and that this I'm writing 5 years ago and I still haven't. As Michael said, we have no idea how many Black people, even ones born here, end up in a psychiatric hospitals. Mm-hmm. To visit a white friend who was in a psychiatric hospital and was struck by the numbers of young Black people in the hospital. This is what he says. I have overheard a young African asking a psychiatrist, why do I keep returning to this place? Is there no cure for mental illness? Mm-hmm. I found this very painful, this is Michael. So I wanted to deal with the fact that there are some Black people in our society that we don't seem to talk about, he explained. Let me see what else we've got here. Okay, so this is from a couple of years ago, pre-lockdown, the BFI put on like lost and forgotten Black films and programs. And this was one, this was the first time I would see this. It was, I saw the museum attendant for the first time, and also this one, the Juju Landlord, which as you can just even see this character here. I think he adapted her from Buchi Emecheta, who is a real life phenomenal mother, writer. She had five children. She took on the literary world and just dominated it. But he was basing this character on some of her experiences trying to rent, study, and raise five children, which they, when she's doing this scene here, they couldn't even believe that. How are you doing this? How are you, a Black woman, studying, and you've got five children to raise as well? But it was a real happening thing. And then, of course, it's this joke about the landlord that she has, that she says is working juju on her. I saw this then. They've obviously got it in the BFI archives. Maybe they'll screen it again. But if they do, you really, these are treats. The museum attendant and this, they were really, they're real treats. But I don't have clips of those because they're vaulted away. Okay. One of those argumentative Guyanese who would try to convince you the color of coffee was green just for the sport of argument. Myself and Michael, we had lots of hot discussions. I loved all of them, though they sometimes left me frustrated. We had mutual respect, and at some point when I showed him my work, he told me I could write. He wanted me to complete this play I was actually working on when I met him. It's still the why can't I finish writing this thing state somewhere. Literally, it still is. Besides getting advice on my writing, when he was writer in residence at my university, I used to visit him just to chat and hear that old school Guyanese accent. Friendship, flimsily built on our shared Guyanese heritage and my aspiration to write, developed. In our later discussions, I could tell he was frustrated because he couldn't come up with new writing material. I had tried convincing him to take a fresh look at the world, perhaps by going back to Guyana. I also tried to get him to write an autobiography, but I suppose I didn't realize fully the mental state he was in at the time, which would be, develop eventually. And this is a picture of Michael. When I met him, he was, you know, as far as I was aware, pretty much he was unmarried. You know, he was looking for love. He was, you know, in that floaty space. And then suddenly he met Liz, and she kind of just blew him away, and he was all in love, you know. And then very soon they got married, and this is him. And I love, I mean, I took this picture, and I love seeing him here because this is when he was really, really very happy that day. Yeah, don't judge me in this picture, but that's me there next to Michael. And this is Uncle Eric, who's on this call. Uncle Eric, this would be the first time that I'm even seeing you. And Auntie Jessica was also at the wedding. I also remember seeing Michael's grandchildren for the first time, and I have pictures of that somewhere floating around. But yeah, this was a big moment in Michael's life. He was just so happy at this point. And in fact, the happiest I saw him was when his wife Liz threw a surprise 70th birthday party for him, which is captured in this photo. But his health was in decline from then, though it would be a while before this became obvious. The marriage with Liz broke down and broke him a bit. He couldn't get over it. He had told me a long time before then about his fear of developing Alzheimer's, from which both his mother and sister had suffered. Some years ago, he had disappeared and was found wandering the streets, beaten up, he told me, by a man accusing him of hustling his woman. Because he was losing track of himself, forgetting where he lived and who, who the people around him were, he was put in a home. When I visited him at this home, he tried to get me to bust him out. He couldn't believe he was there, wondered why Liz, his wife, would commit him to this place. And he thought it a prison where he was locked up for doing what he couldn't understand. And still then, as I recall it, he walked around with pen and paper attempting to write something. This is the, this picture was actually, because we kind of, you know, lost a little bit of touch for a moment because I was probably no longer at the university, neither was him and stuff. And then I don't know how I came upon the fact that he had been missing, and he was in one of our local newspapers. I think I went to see him, and you know, he was beaten. I could see the evidence of that, and we spoke about it. So there were moments when I could obviously clearly speak with him, and at that point I've now rekindled that relationship with him. The Alzheimer's sister is not the sister before me. It's the other sister who passed, and also his mother that he had mentioned. It was miserable seeing him the last time I did. I went with Uncle Eric Huntley and a tender at the time, who is on the call as well. He still seemed to recognize me from our conversation, but became upset when we tried to discuss his condition with the staff. We had hoped to organize some kind of care plan or visit regime. We were told he had become violent to the staff and other residents at the home. He was moved to another where he could get better care, but I never saw him at this new place. I know I couldn't face it after the last difficult time. Last time Liz saw him a couple of weeks ago, which is now obviously 5 years ago, he didn't recognize her, she said. About a week ago, he contracted a chest infection and passed away peacefully. That would have been on the 24th of November, 5 years ago. And so here are some, and there was a group that I was part of when he'd moved back into the North London area, and somehow I managed to coax him to come to this event that we were putting on, coax him out, because by now obviously he's quite reclusive, he's not really coming out, but he comes to this event because it's not far from where he lived. And I remember we went to collect, pick him up, and we assured him we'd pick him up and we'd take him back, and that was the way he came. And I just love how he's like, he's just happy to be out and watching this. I can't even remember now what the play was or what the thing was. Maybe a tender does remember, but it was a group that we had started, and he'd come to that. And yeah, this is us, the group members, and two writers at least here, very much happy to be in his company. He was like our guest of honor at this. And this is Mark Matthew and Eli Ray, community people and writers, and Sister Guyot Chinieri. His last public appearance was in November 2012, when a tribute was organized for him by Errol Lloyd and others at the Tricycle Theatre, which featured a reading of Sweet Talk. He was admired by contemporary Black playwrights like Oladipo Abuluwaj, I can never say his name, and Kwame Nkrumah, for being one among the first to make that mark at the big theatres in the UK, and even by those actors whom he loved to write larger than life stories for, particularly Norman Beaton, with whom he was lifelong friends. And by us all, he will be missed for his fearlessness in a profession that continues, actually, to marginalize many Black artists. He told me in that interview I did with him that he never was anxious about getting his work put on, not in those early days, because, as he said, I decided I would get it on whatever it cost. And it's with that spirit of feistiness I shall always remember him. That's him there. This is on that this is the publication that the interviewer, long interview that I did with Michael, for some reason, I used to send them random stories, what's the theory? They'd never look at it. They were like, rubbish, 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 or whatever way they make the decisions. But I did this interview and I sent it to them, and straight away, no questions asked, they published it. You can still get a copy of this issue, by the way. And that's, those are the details there. It's about £11 or something, but it's quite nice to have, and you really get to see in Michael's thinking. And these are, you probably can't see me, but I'll put it on afterward. These are, I have these two cassette recordings, which I listened to a few days ago, and it was just absolutely amazing just to hear his voice. And, you know, I'm going to try and digitalize them somehow so we could have them. But let me see what else I've got back here. This I'm going to get you to look at on your own regard. This is a production for Channel 4, and it's called Nice. So if you do that in Google, in YouTube, Nice, Norman Beaton. And it's like 25 minutes of Norman Beaton on his own acting, and it is just phenomenal. And the reason why I wanted to illustrate that is because without Michael's writing, we might have still had Norman Beaton in some shape or form, but I think the pairing of the two, being Guyanese brothers, if you like, and Michael loving him loving Michael, them loving working together, that's how we get the Norman Beaton that we, you know, truly love and respect. And he was a phenomenal actor that is also not properly acknowledged. Yeah, yeah. And this now brings us to the day of Michael's funeral, actually. And I took this picture. I remember trying to get all of these actors and theatre people, and I don't know if any of you can recognise them. You could put them in the chat, because I don't know who all of them are. I think the brother, the back there, was on that. There's some that I recognise from that clip that we just saw. This is Oladipo Ulaj, that I'm trying to pronounce his name. This is Yvonne Brewster, who's a very good friend of Michael's. Does anybody recognize anyone else? You could put it in the chat. What you have put in the chat, actually. So, Michelle, your parents still have a stuffed Caiman croc. I'm glad you picked that up. I'm glad you noticed that, because it was a motif that I like.
So, Dad, did you recognize the crocodile, the caiman?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Brilliant, yeah. Wasn't it? Well spotted.
Now, who is the actor from Death in Paradise?
Don Warrington.
Don Warrington, that's who I recognize. Right,
yeah, recognize Don Warrington. Anyone else?
Actually, I have to drop off. It's actually Thanksgiving here in the US. I have to go and cook. Thank you so much for putting this together, and I'll look out for the recording.
Thank you, Michelle, for dropping in. Okay, bye bye.
Bye, Michelle.
Bye.
Yes, I can see lots of you recognize it. Donna can't remember surname. Abigail, that is, yeah, thank you, it's Kroll. Donna Kroll, who is this lady with the locks there. She was recently in a long series, The Long Song, by Andrew Levy. But she, yeah, is quite well known. And, you know, a lot of them will be well known. Don, brother, Professor Gus John in the background there. So it was quite a nice turnout for Michael's funeral. I think Don Warrington did the eulogy, if I recall. You guys didn't know that I didn't know that you were even gonna be here, and look, you're here. you were meant to be here. Look, there's Craig, I wouldn't have known your name. That's me. So that's how the link. And I remember this is a niece, yes. I don't know, are these two,
That's your son.
Richard is our...
That's Richard.
Yes.
Is that Ken?
Right. Yes. Richard is your son. And who is that, Richard's daughter?
No. That's Craig's daughter.
Yes, that's
Craig. Oh, right. I see. Okay, yes. And then...
I realise I'm on mute.
I was going to say, where are you?
Yes, there you go. And there you go at the back. Uncle Eric, you're there as well. Justine, that's your daughter, right?
That is, that's Danielle.
Yeah.
Yes, because I remember... I remember... when I saw her, she was at the wedding. She was smaller then.
Yeah.
That's Peter. I remember chatting with you guys. Look at that.
Okay.
Yeah. What a lovely photo. These are cousins, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That generation. I think one of them was, I don't know if she still is, an aspiring writer, I think. Or loved English or something like that, I remember. Me with you guys. That's it, look at that, Kurt.
Yeah, it's lovely.
And that's just to let everybody know that this is the presentation that I'm gonna be doing in a couple of weeks. I'm now gonna stop sharing. That we can have a general conversation and sharing our exchanges and our memories. And before we do that, I do want to bring in Sister Judy, who shared something with me earlier today. Judy, I know you have to rush off as well, don't you? So do you want to share with Judy, by the way, I don't know whether you were on the call, but now by now you will know. Oh, look, there's Danielle. So Danielle is is Michael's granddaughter, right?
Yeah.
Hello.
How are you all?
Oh, hi, Danielle.
How are you?
Hi. I'm great, thank you.
Oh, it's brilliant to have you on the call.
Thank you. It's lovely to hear everything.
Yeah, it's been about Michael's family. It's just very, very powerful. I can't tell you how powerful that is. I'm really glad you're all here. So we're now just gonna have some people on here know how this usually runs. We then just have like general feedback in talking and sharing and exchanging and celebrating. Sometimes when it's a birthday, we have alcohol to do it. But let's get Judy's words in and then we'll take it over. We can't hear you for some reason. Try again, unmuting.
Richard, is that our Richard?
Our Richard, yes.
Oh, where is he then?
So annoying. I don't know why she's
unmuted, but we can't hear her. Mm-hmm.
It might be a speaker, Sister Judy, because obviously I can see that you're unmuted. We can't say. She was drawing a connection with it would be your father, your grandfather Craig. No, not your.
We're seeing our lips moving. Great. You're not hearing her.
Great grandfather, and some who knew Dr. Neville. So that's what she could remember. That connection. I think she's looking. We'll get to it. Julie, Tanya.
Hi, sorry.
How are you?
I'm all right, thank you. I'm sorry, I could hear you before, but I was in the middle of eating my dinner, so I did not want to turn the microphone on or the screen on. So I was kind of listening and thought I'll have to join later. So fine, thank you.
No, that's great. And welcome, Shalane. I know I know who you are behind the Shell C. I don't know if the Nicole Shelmore. Hi, Shalane.
Hi there. Hi, everyone.
You're right. Shalane, the reason why is because Shalane, we went to the university together. Hello, there she is.
Hi.
We went to London Metropolitan, or it was then North London University, or rather we were working there. I was studying and working there when Michael came. So that's thank you for coming on, Shalane.
Welcome. I like seeing all those old pictures.
Yeah, I know. It's great. I didn't like seeing the one with what's the hair was doing with that. Justine, do you want to say anything?
I've just found it really interesting, and thanks to my cousins for letting me know that this was going to be on tonight. It was really interesting. Some things I knew about, some things I was learning tonight, so that was lovely. And photographs I'll have to get my Uncle Peter to get a copy of. There's a lot of photographs I have, but not some of the ones that you've shown tonight. Beautiful.
Really?
With my aunties and everybody, yeah. Yeah, I do have a lot, but there's some there that I haven't seen before, so they're lovely.
Oh, okay, yeah. Like the earlier ones, I'm taking it that... I keep wanting to say Annette, but Annette is the other sister. What is your name? Is it Elizabeth?
Elizabeth.
Yes. Did you have those pictures, right? The early ones that I showed, the one with you as a child and mum and dad. You have that one.
Who are you talking to? Me? Yes.
Yes, you have that one.
Yes.
And the other one with when you're all in the garden, you have that one as well.
Yes.
Okay, because I don't know. I think I got them from Liz. At the time, so but yeah, and then the other ones, the funeral ones. I have those so. And I probably have more. That was just a few. I know I have more. I have lots more. Mm-hmm. Some of them attended to. Sister Judy, how you doing? Anyone else want to add any comment? Uncle Eric, please.
Well, let me, I'm on mute, aren't I?
No, we can hear you.
You can hear me. Well, what can I, where do I start really? It's great having the family here. Thank you very much for being here to enrich the story, because there are a lot of things about Michael personally that I was not aware of. And of course, for Michelle, for the work that she's done to dig out all the storyline and the records and the archives and the photographs to give a much fuller picture, because when people are alive, you know them, but and yet you don't know them. So this has really enriched my knowledge of Michael, who I knew, not as much as obviously as Michelle. But one of the things that occurred to me is that over the years we have recognized the work of novelists, people who have done novels and stories and so on, fiction and nonfiction. But what we haven't done is to recognize the work done by playwrights and very often by poets. And I would like to really remind ourselves that really speaking, the traditions we come from are very dramatic. Life is the theater, life is drama. And so a lot of our response to the arts and response to everyday life has to do with the theater and drama. And we should really get back to that. I remember when I must have been 6 or 7, and although we are Methodists, there was Salvation Army Church in Bent Street, which is the far end of Bent Street. And I went there and I took part in a play at age of 6, a religious play. And so I think we need to get back to poetry, to the plays and so on, as well as, of course, writing fiction and nonfiction. But I want to really end by thanking Michelle particularly for the basic work, the homework that she's done to make it possible for us to get to know Michael better, to get the family. And funny enough, the pieces on television, the shows on television, didn't seem to have much effect on me and my household. I wasn't quite sure if we had television. Was it black and white? Was it black and white television in those days?
No, that one was color.
It was color. And somehow it didn't seem to have much effect on us, really. Anyway, but really, really, this has been a tremendous evening. Thank you very much, everybody.
Uncle, you were organizing at that time. You were so politically active, like.
You didn't have time for television.
In the 70s. I doubt whether you were really trying to watch.
I only remember that when Akabre was, when my daughter was about 10 years old, we had a black and white, and she ran from upstairs and came down on the ground floor. Daddy, daddy, mommy, there's a black man on television. And this sort of, and we all sort of dropped what we were doing, because to have a black man on television when she was 10 years old was something like if the world had just been created.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
You're a bit embarrassed if you do see it. Sometimes you can be a bit embarrassed when you see them, depending on the role. And that was what was beautiful about what Michael was trying to do. He was trying to break down. I mean, he'll just be like, what's going on? He's just trying to break it down. And listening to the tape, I could show you now. It's actual cassette. And just listening to him, and it's very, very intelligently speaking and considering who he's going to put on. You can see with the clip with the first episode of Empire Road. He wanted his leading character, as played by Norman, to be somebody that was empowered. He had the houses, he was renting houses to everybody. And he also had a grocer's, a greengrocer's shop. We're not seeing anything like that, you know. I think EastEnders, did they try and do that, actually? It might have been, because I vaguely, when it was just whizzing past me, I'm sure there was one of them that was in that scene. But yeah, that's what he was always trying to do. There were always really strong characters with pride and, you know, stuff like that. Because, of course, Michael's coming from that, isn't he? Elizabeth, he's coming from a society of strength, where the women were strong. And he even talks about some of the plays that he was trying to get later on, that he was trying to get on with black women. They wanted black women to be kind of busted, like just weak. And you know, they weren't understanding that, no, you know, she's strong, you know, she's going to face these challenges, but she's, you know, she's strong, she's capable. And so, yeah, those were some of the problems that he was having with some of his later works. Elizabeth, do you want to say anything?
No, I've just found it fascinating. It's wonderful.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
No, you're welcome. I'm just trying to see what Sister Judy has put into the chat. So Judy's saying that my aunt Leone, is it Leone, used to work with the Abbensetts family many years ago, and she often helped out when they had dinner parties. So you had dinner parties, no doubt, Elizabeth.
Yes, we did. We were always having dinner parties.
etc. And she was a superb cook. She worked with Dr. and Mrs. Abbensetts, and she would, I believe, know the young Michael Abbensetts. I spoke to my aunt just over 18 months ago, and she still had fond thoughts of the family. She says, of course, now that Aunt Leona is about 92 and in New York, and Paulie is still very much sharp mentally and tells very beautiful stories of her work and adventures in Guyana before leaving for the USA. Thank you so much, Sister Judy, for sharing that and being able to type it up in the chat. Look at you, though. Look at you, though. We will not let this technology defeat us. Yeah, so no, that's fantastic. That's brilliant. So I'm just seeing on here. Richard, you, I believe, are a relative, because I recognize the name, and from the picture, you are Peter and Elizabeth's son. Is that you behind there, Richard? Or am I imagining things now?
Yes, 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 that's right. Where is he?
He's not showing his picture yet.
All right.
Hello.
Hi, Richard.
Hello.
Hello. How are you?
Struggling to unmute there. Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Yeah, my bandwidth is very bad. If I share a video, it will drop me off. So no video, sorry.
Thank you. It's great to have Michael's family on. I mean, I just think it's tremendous because, funnily enough, yesterday was the actual day that Michael passed. And normally when I have these occasions when it's family or people that I know, you know, friends or whatever that's passed, I would light a candle for them, you know, that they continue to being in the light and so on. And I was busy trying to organize the slides and everything, just busy. I was having a load of technical issues and stuff like that. So I forgot to light the candle. Mm-hmm. And so what I was then trying to do was, because the day before, I knew I had these photos that I wanted to use. And I was like, where, because you've changed system, you've got it on this hard drive, you've got it in this folder. So miraculously the day before, I found the folder with Michael Abbensetts folder, just without even any effort whatsoever. So I was like, oh, look, I found it. So yesterday now, when I'm trying to use the photos to create the slides, I can't find the the folder. So I'm like, look, the day before I just found it. And then I remember I hadn't lit the candle. So I went and I lit the candle and I came back and proceeded to look for the, there it was again, just, and I was like, wow, Michael, you're really like, you know, remember me. So, you know, this is how the spirit works. They don't let you, you can't forget them. And as I said, it was a real special relationship. I don't know who Shazza is on the call. Maybe she wants to say something or he wants to say something. Shazza, who are you? Nicole, who are you? Shazza is a Sharon. Do you think?
Hi, good evening. Sorry, I'm here doing a bedtime routine. I'm just a visitor who was interested in the event.
Okay.
My heritage, my grandmother's from Guyana. I knew nothing about Michael at all until I saw this event listed on Eventbrite, and it looked very interesting. Looking at watching the video earlier, the video clip that you've shown, I was trying to look it up on YouTube to see if I could find that program came out. I think the year that I was born. But it's been really interesting hearing about his history and his life. He seems like a very influential person. Mm. Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you for joining. Mia Morris, who has actually left now, but she's saying here that she had lost contact with Michael's niece, Jennifer Abbensetts, whose last known address was in New York. Do you know this Jennifer Abbensetts? Because obviously all of the Abbensetts are the same Abbensetts. There's no random Abbensetts. It's unrelated, right? She's a niece.
What did you say?
She said all the Abbensetts are connected.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a unique name. So.
Jennifer Abbensetts. Do you know her?
Jennifer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Who?
She went to Canada.
Yeah, that would be your cousin, Auntie Elizabeth.
Yes, 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 of course.
Okay, so Mia Morris apparently must have been, Mia Morris is saying she's lost contact with her. We know who Mia Morris is because she's one of our community champions, really. she's given her email address here. I don't know who I should pass that to. But anyway, whoever is on here, Craig, you're like the doer. Where are you gone? there you are. You could take that email address, Maya Morris. She's sound. She's not like a stalker or anything.
Yeah, I've got it.
Maybe somehow get it to get it to Jennifer Abbensetts. And Justine, I just want to come back to you because some time ago, obviously after the funeral, I think we did contact you myself. Well, I contacted you. I don't know if you or me and Maurice coming back. What happens to you? Have do you have the material, like the videos and all of that?
I've got all the Empire Road ones.
The Empire Roads, yes, those are, yeah, because, yes, because when I've spoken with David from the BFI, who would know whether we have the archives, he said he had the first episode, and I was a bit surprised about that, because I thought, well, where are the rest?
Yeah, I've got, as far as I know, I've got them all, the BBC ones, you know, the pilot and everything. I've got them here, in video format.
So I think at the time when I was thinking about it, I was thinking it's about what happens to that as an archival, as a legacy. I don't know. What do you suggest?
I don't know, to be honest with you. I mean, I've moved in the last 2 years. I was getting ready to move and move, so I've done nothing with everything, but it's all here in my new house.
Where are you in Scotland still?
I'm still in Scotland, but I'm in Fife now. I moved from Perth.
we're like, yeah, okay. Yeah, no, you're not in the Highlands.
No. But I do have, my problem is I don't really know what half of the things are. I've kept absolutely everything though.
I know. I remember at the time it was just because obviously it was very close. There was a lot going on. You would have been had all these boxes. And I remember trying at least to email to say that myself and Uncle Eric at the time, who's here, would have come up and tried to have a conversation or figure out what to do with this material. Because otherwise the material after you have someone like me who's got the energy to at least fathom what we could do with this.
Yeah.
Very much interested in us having it organized in a way where it could be, they would obviously digitalize it, archive it, however way they want. I wonder if that's why, but the BBC should have copies anyway. Those what you've got, I imagine, are Michael's copy. And I know you have them because I saw them
at
his house. And that was when I was interviewing him. I think I watched all of those episodes, and also I watched the Black Christmas. That's how I remember, because it's still vivid in my mind. But you can't, that's nowhere online or that you can access, which is fair enough, because you want to like preserve its integrity. But it has to be in some space where if they want to show it, for example, you know, that can happen. Do you see what I mean? I mean, I could speak with David Somerset who is at the BFI, and find out what might be a good method for it to be archived, but with it, you maintaining that integrity of it, if you see what I mean.
Just whatever you think.
Yeah, and I will speak with Uncle Eric again about that prolonged and detained visit. Maybe Craig. Craig, did you book this? Like, did you press that Eventbrite link? Is that how you got this?
Yes, I did, yeah.
Which means I should have your email then.
Yeah, also, I don't know if you look at your Instagram messages, but I messaged you on Instagram and you've not replied. But I was thinking, it's the worst way of messaging people, so it's like I'm always missing things on there, so for the moment you're off the hook, but but we should but about
three messages because I'm very look it hasn't
But I mean, about that archiving, I'd be really interested in helping with that. I think I might know a few people who could,
great,
who could help with things like that. So let's get in touch, Michelle, and about everything, and then, you know, and also You know, I don't know, whatever else is available, I suppose.
Yeah, well, this is it. Because that's why I was saying, like, that, because I know that the BFI have that archive stuff. So when I had spoken with David, he was saying, so for example, I kind of last minute, because this was all really for me put together last minute, contacted him about whether they had clips of Black Christmas or whatever. And he said, it probably takes a little bit longer than I had asked him to do that. So they do have some stuff. And clearly I saw the juju landlady via the BFI, and I also saw the museum attendant. So they do have stuff, but it's like going cross-referencing what they have with what Justine has, and to make sure that, you know, we have an integrity, we have a Michael Abbensetts collection, because the BFI, as long as it's going, will recycle and will show things. And I think public, so for example, if I wanted to do another thing, because we talked about that, like say Michael's birthday, if I give him enough time, he could make it accessible to me. Do you see what I mean? But as long as we have them. So yeah, me and Morris, I don't know if you can hear me, but I read your message to the family, and we could be in touch with Craig if you want. You two could even exchange whatever private, well, he's seen your email now, so he's gonna contact you. Okay, so yeah, so I think it's been great. It's I don't have anything else to say. It's been about Michael clearly wanted his family here, and that's what's happened.
Mm-hmm. Oh, fantastic. Funny, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, no, thank you so much, Michelle.
I'd love to be in touch with Jennifer. I've not seen her in over 30 years. She was an old friend of mine, and she used to supply me in Essence magazines. And I used to go to her parents to pick it up in Bromley before they moved to New York. And she was an only child, and she used to work for United Nations. And I lost contact with her before 9/11. So I don't know whether she got caught up in that. And I've always wondered whether what's happened to her.
Okay. Well, Craig is going to email her.
Yeah, we'll hook up somehow.
And give her your contact details. Craig, did you say?
Oh wait, no, hang on. No, I don't know her details, but I can connect with the rest of Tanya, you might know more.
Well, I was just about to interject, if you can you hear me?
Yeah.
Right, it's just, but I have my box hasn't lit up. Yes, I have been in touch with her daughter. I'm trying to remember what her daughter's name was. Danielle, I think. Yes. Via, because she approached me via Ancestry of all places, because she was researching the Abbensetts family. So I've had a few conversations with her online, so I could get in touch with her daughter and pass on that, you know, right. Is there any chance of getting in touch with her mum? Because her mum's still around, so.
Oh, wonderful. I thought she died. Sorry.
No, she hasn't. No.
Justine. Because
9/11, the United Nations was hit by it, you see, and she worked there.
Yes, I don't think she works there anymore, and I don't think she worked there when that happened. I'll get if Craig can pass on any details, or whoever's got the information can pass details on to me, I can pass it on to her daughter via that way, and I'm sure she'll be in touch.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, I've got your details, Mia, so I've just sent
Michael
them to
would have been
sister.
So proud to have seen this event organised for him.
Yeah, I'm sure he would.
He's from the old school.
Yes, he is from the old school. Craig, you send it on way with words, like the message.
Did I say that again? Sorry.
The Instagram.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, yeah, because I've got two. I've got my Michelle, my me, and then
words.
So I'm very rarely on the way with words. I'm doing the old.
You advertise the event on there, but I
advertise it on both places. So I'll see.
Yeah. Okay.
Sister Jackie.
Yeah, send me your email address, and then we can.
I will connect with you. In fact, just in case there was some glitch that I didn't, I'm just going to send it to you now in here. So, okay, great. Do you want to say something? I see you've just written it in the chat, but please, you can unmute yourself.
No, it's been wonderful.
Yes. I did just say in the chat, I mean, that this was a tremendous experience because this is the first memorial tribute that I've been to online and seeing the family linked in these numbers, you know, and that feels very rich because it shows your interest as a family and your love as a family and the fact that you all given the time to support Sister Michelle's tremendous work. I just want to applaud you all and to say how fantastic it is for me to have been here. I was out earlier today and I rushed home, must have been about minutes to six, and I thought, do I link in? Do I link in? And I'm in the kitchen getting a cup of tea.
Take care.
And I'm really glad I was rewarded. Thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you, Michelle.
Thank you.
No, it's a proper treat. It's a real treat.
Lovely.
Yeah, oh no, thank you. I remember you all. I remember you all very fondly and very warmly on that day when we sent Michael home. So I'm grateful. People for logging on, and we will keep in touch. I think it was meant to happen. It happened for the rightful reasons, you know, and so the spirit is just continuing to work. We mustn't forget people just because they're not, we can't see them anymore, you know, they are there. And listening to these recordings that I did with Michael, you know, made me, it was just that instantness of our friendship, and it was just odd, generations apart, but I was just kind of like a bit feisty, and he was equally feisty. So we just used to argue about so many different things because he's very, very strong-willed. He just thought he had some kind of wild, wacky ideas out there, you know, and I would try and rein him in, and then just loads of love and joy. I even dug up some emails that he'd sent all those years ago, Shalane, when we were at uni. I found those old emails that, you know, we'd used to exchange all these random jokes, and I'd forgotten that he'd gone into hospital to have this, and he said, you know, and he's thanking me, and I'm thinking, you know, it's like you can't even remember that you have this world of a relationship with this man. And I think I'm so glad that I was able to bring that to some of it for you here today, and to know that, yeah, I did abridge what I read just now, and it did go in the Stabroek newspaper in Guyana as an obituary. So I made sure that he was remembered there as well. And on Facebook, I don't know if you guys know Rowan Abbensetts.
No.
No.
What?
Never heard that name.
How do you not know that one as well then? You don't know Rowan Abbensetts. Oh my goodness. This is, the plot just gets thicker and thicker. So I don't really know him either. I've not physically met him.
Was he some relation?
Yes, we connected on Facebook. And Michael and him were, you know, like friends and family, because he sent, so I shared the event on Facebook and the memory and stuff like that from yesterday on Facebook. And Rowan tagged into it and actually booked to come on here. So I was kind of looking to see if he was on here. And he's saying, and then he shared a picture of him and Michael and the family. So I'm really surprised that you guys don't know him. So I will speak to him and say, like, hello, why did you come on it? You would have met some of your family. Yeah. But he's a good person, I think, Rowan, to be in touch with as part of the family, the extension. Anyway, everybody, well, I just want to bid you a very good evening. And until the next time.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
No, thank you all for joining.
Yeah, thanks, Michelle.
Yeah. Thank you. It's been great.
Thank you. You know, wonderful.
Thanks very much. Michelle, do you still have my email address?
Actually, probably, I don't know. So how would I get it, Craig?
I can do the exchange of addresses or phone numbers or
thank
something.
Thank you, Craig. That would be great. I used to live in Scotland, by the way. So
did you? What part?
Stirling. I went to university.
Oh yeah. I used to live about half an hour from Stirling. I'm quite a distance away now.
Yeah. Five sound, all of those, they just sound far. Like five, it's so definite as well.
It's only about maybe 10 miles from St Andrews, where I'm living now.
Right, okay. Nice. St Andrews, I think I went there once.
But
thank you all. Have a wonderful
evening.
Until the next time.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye.